comments.
Let's call the public hearing to order, and this is on the proposed annexation agreement for Plum's Farm, 145-acre parcel. Can you call the roll, Madam Clerk?
Trustee Palafis.
Present.
Trustee Stanton.
Here.
Trustee Gata.
Present.
Trustee Vandenberg.
She's here somewhere.
Trustee Mills.
Present.
Trustee Newell.
Present.
Mayor McLeod.
Present. And we'll now commence the public hearing part. I'm making sure the education of the audience there will be a committee meeting following this, where this chapter will be discussed, and then potentially the board meeting, if the committee makes a favorable recommendation. If anyone want to come forward at this point and say anything, just identify yourselves from the
You know, perhaps it should be said that if they speak now, they should not speak later. Yeah, I noticed. I hate to see duplication. Mm-hmm. When they give us these.
I would like to have a 3-minute time limit, if people could respect that. I'd appreciate it. Go ahead, sir. Name and address for the record.
Is that microphone on?
Hold on a second, sir. I want to make sure the mic is on.
Try it again. Pull it down.
Okay, good.
You're good.
All right. Start over, or?
Yeah, you start over. That's fine.
My name is Mike Tennis. I live at 303 Churchill Court in Sleepy Hollow. For the third time, I ask you to use good judgment this evening. Why would the board want to consider a request from Golden Goose, Rubina, and Plum Farms to annex 145-acre parcel? What do they offer other than intense density with 7 apartment buildings up to 10 stories and as many as 1,325 units? Why would anyone buy a single-family home in a mixed-use development with 4, 5, or 10-story structures? Who will reside in this Northwest Cabrini Green environment? Where will their plus 1,000 children go to school? What parents want their child to be bused 38 miles every day to and from Hampshire? It is unsafe for the children, and too costly for District 300 residents, especially seniors. The developer represented the project was targeting millennials and empty nesters. The document filed with the village on January 25th, on page 10, paragraph O, refers to low and very low income housing units as defined in Section 3 of the Illinois Affordable Housing Act, which is a euphemism, just like the Affordable Care Act. Allowing such density will be unaffordable for District 220 and 300 and will strain the public safety services of this village. The next paragraph, P, refers to the need for daycare services for children of employees from low-income families. Does that sound like an arboretum shopper? If annexation goes forward with the levels of density proposed, the Arboretum will be forever devalued. Why not build on the upscale nature of the retail neighborhood? I may be wrong, but it seems to me the developer's goal is to attract residents fleeing Chicago's violence and high taxes. Let's recognize the demographics. Millennials and empty nesters are fleeing the state seeking employment opportunities and lower taxes. What are future employment opportunities going to be like at Sears? Do you want to encourage low and very low income residents accustomed to a heavy dose of safety net services that will be challenged, that will challenge future village boards and erode Hoffman Estates' reputation? Money Magazine ranked Hoffman Estates number 27 as the best place to live in 2016. Will this board be remembered for maintaining the village's reputation or give in to growth for growth's sake? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else? Again, if you can try to keep it to 3 minutes. And again, we will be dealing with this at least once more this evening in the committee meeting, if not twice more. Yes, sir. Identify yourself for the record.
Good evening. My name is Brian Battle, and Dr. Brian Harris, our superintendent, both representing Barrington 220 School Districts, 310 James Street, Barrington. With two of us, hopefully you'll give us 5 or 6 minutes. We will try to be quick. We're giving you a handout that's circulating about statements on the school impact for the annexation zoning and development agreements all before you this evening. Number one, we continue to support the rights of the landowners and the Village of Hoffman Estates to develop the property at 59 and 72. Based on the past developments within Hoffman Estates, we believe the village will ensure that the school impact will be addressed in the final development plan. In support of that objective, though, we do believe that the annexation and zoning and development agreements should incorporate a number of changes, and we'll just present those quickly to you tonight. I'll turn it over to Dr. Harris for the first couple.
On your handout here, you will see them listed A through E, and I'll walk through each one of these quickly. First, land for schools. I was here several weeks ago and stated once again how important it is with a development of this size to be able to have an appropriate space for schools in this type of a housing development. Based on the size of the development, as well as the land use recommendations in the Hoffman Estates Ordinance, the Plums Farms agreement should allocate at least 25 to 35 acres for school use. The cash in lieu payment option should not be allowed due to size of the development. If cash in lieu payment is allowed, the value per acre should be reviewed based on the area pricing to make sure it's relevant. Currently, your ordinance has $1,000. Construction of school buildings, another huge commitment with this size of a development in any other suburban environment here in the Chicago area. We believe the scope of the proposed development warrants the construction of a new school building by the school districts, and the agreement should reflect that requirement. If an impact fee is relied upon to provide funds for building capital, the agreement should provide a per pupil impact fee for building capital of at least $6,612, which should make the impact fee comparable to other impact fee agreements anywhere in our area. This proposed impact fee represents less than 10% of the proposed impact on the schools, requiring additional capital for the developer for those buildings. If you want a detailed analysis, it's attached there and you can look through the numbers. We have worked hard on this to show the relevance, the impact on our schools. C, prohibition of the TIF district funding. While I'm happy to hear that it has currently been removed for consideration for this development, given the extensive review and the discussion on the eligibility and the negative impact on the schools that are generated by the TIF district on this property, we believe the agreements that you're considering tonight should permanently prohibit the use of TIF district on any property that includes residential development. It's clearly unacceptable.
Additionally, as you know, we've expressed concern to you about the student density. We believe the agreements before you tonight should reflect a reduced density and size by creating a lower maximum number of dwelling units. The magnitude of the proposed zoning and development creates a significant financial burden on the taxpayers of District 220 and 300, as we have previously presented to you. The current proposed agreement allows a significant increase, greater than 30%, from the conceptual plans of 1,035 up to, depending on how you interpret the contract, either 1,400 or 1,325 in maximum dwelling units. This is a significant change from the information that we have been previously provided by the village and developer. So again, we think the agreement should reflect reduced density. Finally, we ask that you consider a school board approval in the final plans. We believe the agreement should allow for approval of the affected school districts for the final development plans. Any objection cited by the school district must be based on projected financial and operational impact to its taxpayers. We acknowledge this request is not typical, but the scope of this development is not typical either. Therefore, we feel it is appropriate for the agreements before you tonight. And finally, we just want to reiterate and offer our continued efforts to modify the proposed agreements to reflect the above changes. We respectfully request the trustees to provide the school districts with that opportunity in the future to work with the village staff and developer to incorporate these changes in the agreements before you this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Again, we will be addressing this issue in the committee meeting that'll be forthcoming. So either speak now or do it later.
I'm John Anderson. I office over at 2300 North Hoffman or Barrington Road in Hoffman. And I've been the color man for HETV and prep football game of the week for Hoffman for the last 6 years. I think one of the factors here that has to be brought out, we've talked a lot about density of houses, density of people, but a big factor that has not been talked about much is density of cars. The truth of the matter is we're 38 miles from downtown Chicago. We don't have mass transit. There's going to be a lot of cars there. To go any place out here, you need a car. And even some of these houses that are on, that would be on your 3,000 or 5,000 square foot lots would still be with people with at least two cars, maybe three cars. Sometimes by the time the younger teenager is 16, it's four cars. And you're going to have cars along the street. The scene here in winter, if you have 3-4 inches of snow, you're going to have the same thing that they have in Chicago where they can't get plows through or anything. The density of cars is a big factor that really has not been talked about much at all, and I think it needs to be weighed in. I think you really need to go with a minimum lot size here of about 7,500 or 10,000 in order to accommodate the cars. We're going to have a little bus terminal over here at I-90, but that's a long ways from this site. I can't see somebody trudging through the snow all the way to that to hop on a bus. So everybody, if you live out here, you need cars for everybody 16 and over. That's the reality. There's not enough room for the cars when you have lots that are 3,000 and 5,000 square feet. You've got to go with bigger lots than that. I think the neoclassic traditional design has some merit, but I think you have to have that minimum lot size higher. I think the grid pattern has a lot to be said for it. We've all been in these cul-de-sac traps where you go deep into a cul-de-sac and you've got to turn around and go back out, and kids that live on one cul-de-sac have to walk four blocks to get to the kid on the next block. And with a grid pattern, it's better with short blocks on a grid pattern. It's much more pedestrian friendly, but you still need to put the cars somewhere. And some of these really small houses, I don't know if they'd have one car garages or two or what, but certainly they're going to have a lot of two-car houses and three and so on, and they're going to wind up on the street. And certainly if guests come over, they're parking in the street, and you're going to have very, very crowded streets there. So I would say the minimum lot size here should be 7,500, perhaps 10,000.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else? Again, I would emphasize that we will be dealing with this in a committee meeting. Name and address for the record, sir.
Bernard Kerman, 31 Denali Court, South Barrington, Illinois. Let me put my cheaters on. Good evening, Your Honor.
Good evening.
Good evening, my fellow trustees. I say fellow trustees because, besides being a resident of South Barrington and the Regency, the active adult community just east of Route 59, I am also a village trustee. Just as you have taken an oath to uphold the laws and codes of your village, so have I. Just as you have taken an oath to uphold the Constitution of the state of Illinois, so have I. So let's forget all the gobbledygook about TIFs, traditional neighborhoods, whatever that means, however you define it, restructuring and rezoning codes to satisfy a few. Let's forget the contract between the builder and the homeowner and the prospective buyer, and the small print that in so many words warns buyer beware. Beware of the noise, the hazards of derailments, of approximately 25 to 30 freight trains going through there every day, mostly between 2 and 4 o'clock in the morning. Let us forget about the hazards of vibrations from those freight trains of 25 to 30 every day, mostly between 2 and 4 o'clock in the morning. That is not our job. That is not our job as trustees. Our job is to make sure there is no need for buyer beware. But let's instead examine the most important document we all took to uphold. A document that some say is more important, word for word, than even the Christian Bible or the Jewish Torah. And it's a fraction of the size of either one. Do you know what that is? It's the Constitution of the United States of America. Why is that important? 51 years ago, as I was being inducted into the armed services back in 1966, I chose not to run to Canada or hide behind some other lame excuse not to serve. I felt it my obligation and duty. And some 50 years later, I took that same oath to protect and defend the Constitution of the United States and to serve all people of South Barrington and the surrounding communities. Let's examine what the U.S. Constitution says. It starts off, "We, the people of the United States, in order to serve a more perfect union."
Can you wrap it up, sir? Other people want to
establish
talk.
Justice, sir, and ensure domestic tranquility.
Your 3 minutes is up, but let somebody else speak. Let somebody else speak. Does anyone else want to come forward? Again, this will be at a committee meeting after this is over with.
Mr. President, I'm Tom Burney, 40 West Brink Street, Crystal Lake, Illinois. I'm representing the homeowners who live across the way on Route 59. We have several objections to this proposal. This is a hearing on the annexation agreement, and it's prescribed by law, and that's why this board is going through this right now. First of all, this is moving way too fast. My clients attended the meeting at the Planning and Zoning Commission. They studiously looked over all the materials that were presented as part of the packet attached as part of the agenda. There was no initial traffic plan, which is mentioned in the annexation agreement. There was no physical impact study, no market study. There's reference in the agreement that's before you tonight that's subject to this public hearing to a 2004 annexation agreement. They've never had the opportunity to look at that. And so we would like to provide some meaningful comment based on all of the information that's a part of this, and that's why we'd ask that this board slow this process down a little bit. Second of all, I wanted to point out that the way that this arrangement is set up, there isn't going to be another public hearing. The people that I represent, the people in South Barrington, the people in Barrington Hills, the other neighbors are not going to get another public hearing notice about this. What you're doing is zoning this ground TN. And I think that that's important for you to remember, because I believe that this agreement is taking away so much of the discretion that village boards like yourself have over development. There are no limits in this agreement in terms of development except a maximum number of, I believe, 1,325 units. There is no minimum requirement of single-family homes. There is no requirements in terms of where these various uses. There was this real pretty picture with multicolors on it, which sort of set where things were going to go, but that's not attached as part of the annexation agreement. The only thing that's attached as part of the annexation agreement is an Exhibit D, and it identifies four neighborhoods. And those, the only limitations in terms of those neighborhoods, in terms of the people who live on the other side of 59, is that no building or structure can be more than 58 feet high. That is a five-story, it could be a five-story apartment building under the discretion that you're giving to the developer in this annexation agreement. We ask you to impose controls, minimum numbers of single-family homes, locations where these uses can appear, not to simply say you can build 1,325 dwelling units on this piece of ground, and you can pretty much do it anywhere you want on that piece of ground. The last thing, and I have a lot more to say, but I respect the president's admonition about 3 minutes, is that we're going to hear a lot about the 2004 annexation agreement, and I haven't seen it. But what I do recall is that that this ground, when that 2004 annexation agreement was entered into, and when it was talking about the other property, that ground was in another municipality, Barrington Hills, and it went through a long, arduous process to get disconnected. But I don't think, and I don't think that there's any precedent for being able to enter into a binding annexation agreement or pre-annexation agreement on ground that's in some other municipality. The statute in Section 1 of the annexation agreement statute specifically provides that the ground that's the subject of this pre-annexation agreement is in the unincorporated area, not within the territorial limits of another municipality. So I have several other things. I'll save them for the rest of the hearing, but okay. We would ask you to slow down, to add limitations in this annexation agreement, and to not give up your discretion, and to also require that when these development parcels come in, that legal notice be provided so that everybody has an opportunity. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Burney. Name and address for the record, please.
It's Matthew Holmes, 360 Hawthorne Lane, Hoffman Estates. I'm also one of the attorneys for the Village of South Barrington. I've been a municipal attorney for 13 years, and I've dealt with zoning and land use matters on a weekly basis for the entire time. And like Attorney Burney, I'd like to point out that this is moving at a very, very high rate. I do not recall ever being at a series of meetings where an annexation hearing, a plan and zoning committee meeting, and a board meeting for approval of annexation, subdivision, and rezoning all occurred in the same evening in that 13 years. I'm afraid in the village's rush to approve this project, details and required documents are being missed. By expediting the procedure through annexation, subdivision, and rezoning, you're relying on the annexation agreement and the new TN zoning to govern what can be done in this project without limits. And this is without having reviewed, as Mr. Burney said, traffic studies, fiscal impact analyses, engineering plans, or wetland studies. To my knowledge, these documents, although required in the village subdivision code, were not submitted by the developer. Further, the village has had no opportunity to review detailed plans for street improvements, utility easements, drainage, or public improvements at this time. Further, at the April 5th meeting, my client called to the village's attention that no petition has currently been filed with the North Cook County Soil and Water Reclamation District. That petition is required by statute. Section 70 ILCS 405-22.02A states as follows. Any person who petitions any municipality or county agency in the district for variation, amendment, or other relief from that municipality or county zoning ordinance, or who proposes to subdivide vacant or agricultural lands therein, shall furnish a copy of such petition or proposal to the Soil and Water Conservation District. The Soil and Water Conservation District shall be given not more than 30 days from the time of receipt of the petition or proposal to issue its written opinion concerning it, essentially to the municipality. To my knowledge, that petition was never filed by the petitioner in this case. When this was called to the attention of the Village of Hoffman Estates, The Village of South Barrington received a response that was told that such petitions are filed in conjunction with specific development plans, including detailed engineering documents, tree surveys, and other information, quote, none of which is available yet for the Plum Farms property. However, the statutory requirement applies to subdivisions, such as those considered before the board this evening. The lack of detail and documentation in the application for subdivision filed by Plum Farms does not exempt it from the statutory requirement. Rather, indicate to the village that insufficient detail has been presented to allow the subdivision to proceed at this time.
Can you wrap it up, sir? Your 3 minutes is up.
Absolutely. The residents of Hoffman Estates and the residents of adjacent communities deserve an opportunity to review and comment on the details of the proposed annexation, subdivision, and development. I would ask that this matter either be denied by this board this evening, or at a minimum, that it be continued until such time as more specific documentation has been provided by the developer. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Good evening.
Welcome, Madam Mayor.
Yep, Paula McCombie, 30 South Barrington Road, Mayor of South Barrington. I just would ask that you look at this agreement and spend more time on it. I've been at your last three meetings, your Planning Commission meeting. This is a huge development, and a lot has changed since the original, since we talked to Anthony Iatarola a few weeks ago. We were talking five-story apartment buildings. Now we're talking up to 125 feet. We're talking about bigger two-family residences. Now we're talking about 400 square foot in each of the residences. And I would just hope that you look at our school district as well and make sure that, 220, which you will be part of, that you're making sure that they're going to have enough money, that it's not going to impact the students that are going to be going to that school. The other thing in the consultant's report for Anthony Iatarola, it said that it fits in with the surrounding area. Well, it's something totally different. I don't know. I can't see how that could be really called a fit. It's a unique development. And so I just ask that you look at these things again and take some time and maybe put some things in the annexation agreement that will both protect you and will also protect South Barrington to make this a great development for Hoffman Estates. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. Christina Anderson, 515 Pondgate Drive in Barrington Hills. I would have spoken later, which I think is better for you guys, but I have to do kid pickup, so I apologize for taking three of your minutes right now. As many of you know, I'm speaking as a representative of a group called District 220, District 300, and Hoffman Estates Residents Against Irresponsible Development. I would hazard a guess that most of the people in this room are members of that group. And I just find it really interesting that in all of your meetings that I've been to, there's only been one Hoffman Estates resident who's spoken in favor of the development, and that's Mr. Iatarola. So we're not hearing a lot of support from the community for it, at least from what I can tell. And we, as a group of taxpayers, have grave concerns that have been already articulated tonight and will be articulated further, simply about the density, the suitability to the community, the suitability to the surrounding area, the burden on both the schools, the police, the fire, the roads. We would ask you all to support responsible development. We know Hoffman Estates does develop, continues to develop, does lots of good things. We have great faith in your judgment, but you need to send this annexation back, agreement back, and the zoning proposal back for much lower density. It doesn't suit the community, and it's not supported by your taxpayers or any of these people. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mayor and trustees, thank you very much for this opportunity to speak to you. I'm Janet Agnoletti. I'm the Executive Director of the Barrington Area Council of Governments, BACOG, and I have a long history of working in planning and with development with BACOG, like 16 years. I'm a regional planner by education and by profession, and so this property has been on my radar screen for almost two decades. The site under consideration, the Plum Farms, is surrounded by these land uses. Forest preserves, zero density, Barrington Hills a little farther north, 5-acre zoning, South Barrington at 1 acre, one unit per acre, and commercial uses to the south along 72. In planning practice, we would hope to see Plum Farms density to be similar to the uses around it or to be a transition development that would fit in with what's around it. At the last Plan Commission meeting, a member of the development team said the land use is transitional. Plum Farms is proposed at 7 times the residential density of adjacent South Barrington, 37 times the density of Barrington Hills, where it was located until 2009, and it will have up to 200,000 square feet of commercial and retail uses on the same site. So as a planner, I tell you, it's really hard to see this area, this development, as a transition in the area. Is proposed for traditional neighborhood development, a new category described in your staff report as more similar to traditional urban neighborhoods than typical suburban design. Whether people will want this kind of density, time will tell, but I can tell you that it is troublesome to the people who live in the area now. I think you know that, you know, it's being designed and approved in Hoffman Estates, and the benefit from taxes will go to Hoffman Estates for the sales taxes anyway. But the people who will be paying for the governmental districts and services live in other communities. We're really glad to see the TIF request withdrawn, but a significant part of the cost burden really comes just from the density. So as neighbors, we would ask you to consider lowering the densities and the impact on the residents in adjacent communities. As the organization, BACOG, that researched and developed the regional impact fee ordinance for all of the Barrington communities and beyond, and is in use in other communities adjacent to us too, we ask that the values in the BACOG area ordinance be used. So that goes to the school district's point about the land value per acre, the amount of land per school type, and also the demographics, which under the annexation agreement say they reserve the right to do their own study. But in the land value, just to give you an example, Hoffman agreement sets out the land value at $108,900 per acre. In the Barrington ordinance, and this was done by appraisal regionally, the land value is almost $248,000 for elementary and middle schools per acre.
You're past 3 minutes. Can you wrap it up?
Okay, $442,000 for the high school. So it's a lot less. So we are asking to use the BACOG impact fee ordinance and also to do an in-depth site analysis that is environmental, because we know from our groundwater work that this is a lot of clay. Stormwater is going to sit there for a long time. So we recognize that you have the right to develop as you think is best for your community, but we also hope that you will consider the impacts on your neighbors in your final decision.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Eric Weatherholtz with Healy Weatherholtz Properties in Atlanta, Georgia. I came up today. Our company is involved in retail and mixed-use developments around the country. We also represent retailers looking for space in those types of projects. We originally got involved with Poplar Creek Crossing and bringing Archon to the site, and have followed the development of the corridor, have a close relationship with the Arboretum owners, and have worked with the Iatarola family to discuss the plans for that space. We would have, in our discussions with retailers for the area, we've gotten a lot of positive response to the area, and have seen the idea of a mixed-use, vibrant, almost town center type development evolving on that site has gotten the most amount of interest from the retail community as retailing has sort of shifted over the past few years. And the one thing that we've heard is that of all the great things about Hoffman Estates and that site, probably the knock against it is from a retailing standpoint, commercial standpoint, is the lack of rooftops in the area. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir, name and address for the record.
John McLendon, Streetscape Development, 8149 Skokie. So we work with the Iatarola family to develop the master plan. And we presented previously to this group, we did a project in Libertyville, and we recognize that named School Street. We recognize this is not Libertyville. However, that project was done in the midst of the housing crisis, and we were one of the only new home developments in the country that was selling homes. And the learnings from that was that you need to give people choices. So we believe a home is the ultimate consumer product. It's where you're going to play your life out with your family, where you're going to connect with the community, and everything earlier was conveying that density is bad. And I would argue that density is good. It creates vibrancy. It creates a walkable, pedestrian-friendly neighborhood. It promotes growth. And that is not because we were saying that. We're very fortunate in that a number of media outlets covered the story. And it wasn't a development story or a density story. It was how Americans are choosing to live story. So it was covered by the Wall Street Journal, Fortune Magazine, the Today Show. Washington Post sent a senior reporter out, lived with a customer that we built a home for 3 days and wrote her about her experience. So a gentleman earlier mentioned the Constitution. What could be more American than giving people choices? And I think everyone here would appreciate the fact that they can have a choice, whether it's a 60-foot wide lot or a 30-foot wide lot or living in an apartment. So I think this project promotes where the American dream is moving, and we would appreciate your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Again, we will be dealing with this in a committee meeting, but go ahead, name and address, sir.
Yeah, good evening. Bob Lee from 25 Canyon Court, South Barrington. I have only one question, so I don't need 3 minutes. My question is, how long you think it's going to take to get this new development place completed in the field? As you, gentlemen, you just said, many people probably want it. I was here in this room March 15th for another hearing, which is another development at Hoffman Estate and Shoe Factory Road. That project has 108 homes. And with the history, the developer said it needs probably more than 4 years to sell all the houses. So with over 1,000 units, how long is it going to take? There's no limit when this is supposed to be complete. If only very few sold, what left over, what we do with it? Thank you.
Thank you.
Bernadine Rosenthal, 8 Old Coach Drive, South Barrington, Illinois. I just have a quick question, and maybe this can be answered in the next segment. If we're talking 1,325 homes, we should be talking double that for the amount of cars, which makes it 2,650. Then if you have children in any of these residents, we can add on a few more hundred, perhaps, cars. Do they have two-car garages? Is there parking on the street? What happens when we have a tremendous snow fall? We don't have enough land to put the snow on a 3,000-square-foot lot. Maybe that can be answered later. I'm just asking the question because I'm really curious how this is all going to work, and I'm sure Public Works Department maybe has figured this all out, but I think it's a very interesting question. Do we have garages for these cars? And if you have these apartment buildings, the apartment buildings are too large to accommodate parking underground, so the parking has to be spread out. Are we going to have garages like downtown Chicago where you rent space in the garages? I don't know. I'm confused. Maybe you can explain it later. Thank you.
Thank you. If there's no one else, we've got a couple.
Thank you. I'll be brief. My name is Ryan Murphy. I'm a principal with Vequity. I've been involved in retail real estate for over 20 years as part of two national brokerage companies. You've got a very unique opportunity before you tonight, one of the last of its kind, truly, in Chicago. The opportunity to do a national recognized development, master plan community along the lines of a Seaside, Florida. These communities tend to be very dense. The first question I get asked from my retailers as they come to Chicago is, we love this corner, but we need density. For this retail to be successful, we have to have density here. You're fortunate. You've got a very patient, visionary family that's getting incredible consultants involved in this project. One of the comments was that this is not going to be an upscale community. I'm sorry, but to have an ice skating rink and the forethought of ball fields and walking paths, this is going to be an amazing community. Thank you for the opportunity to speak before you tonight.
Thank you.
Rubina Nguyen from South Barrington, 36 Willow Bay Drive. Two questions for you. One, this has been posed previously, and I reiterate many, many residents' sentiments here. Why the rush to push this through so quickly? You have to be able to answer this to everybody's satisfaction. Second, the last couple of comments we are hearing how vibrant and how perfect this community is that's being planned. But at the same time, very gleefully overlooking the impact it's going to have on the surrounding communities that have been painstakingly built over several generations, many, many years. Our school district, just take 220 for instance, we're already dealing with a bit of a crowding issue, if not more. And let's say if this doesn't even affect 220, I would still be standing here and asking you, why would you sacrifice the education of tens of thousands of students just to benefit one family? Why sacrifice so many families for the benefit of one family? You have to be able to give us a very good answer for that. That's all. Thank you.
Hi there. I'm Michael Smith. I'm at 1495 West Newcastle Court in Inverness. I invested in this project, right? And I did so, I got three kids at Barrington. I like this community a lot. I thought this thing is really cool. Like, if you look at what's going on in the Glen right now, how many people would talk about Glenview if we didn't have the Glen? To me, that's a really impressive project. What's happening downtown? I represent international businesses. What's happening? They're all going downtown. And why are they going downtown? Because today, young people don't want to live in large urban sprawl. They want to live in cool communities where they have smaller units. They want to have commercial area around them. My kids don't necessarily want to come back here to Barrington, but Barrington area, Hoffman Estates area, but I want them to, right? I want them to have a place that they want to come to. And people talk about cars. Cars in 10 years, we're not even going to have cars. This is going to be an evolving world that we're living in now. And we just built a billion-dollar expressway right next to this development. So the people that come to this development are going to be commuting back and forth on that expressway, and we're going to have to find other ways to have them commute. But it's not going to be the current commuting patterns. It's going to be something very different. So for us to talk about parking garage and all that stuff, I mean, I understand it, and I understand the fear of what this does to the community. People in South Barrington, Barrington Hills, they've got a very nice situation in Inverness. But it's not the situation of the future, and it's not what the retailers are looking for. It's not what businesses are looking for, right? Zurich went out on a deep limb to build their headquarters there. I mean, I know them well. That's a stretch for them. Where's Motorola? They left, right? What happened to Motorola Mobility in Libertyville? They left. Why do they leave? Because they don't have places like this where the kids can move into, where the people like me when I sell my house can move into. This is going to be a really neat thing. And so there may be some people who are fearful about it, but the reality is most of the commuting pattern is either going to be in downtown on that expressway, or it's going to be to the shops and towns and other things around where people want to get to. It's not going to be driving around South Barrington or Barrington Hills. So that's my 3 minutes, but that's why I invested in it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is John Dennis. I'm with Urban Street Group. We're an apartment building developer contemplating a project on this site. I'm at 401 West Superior in Chicago. I'm here to speak in support of the project. We believe it's a very good market for apartments. I support the mix of uses and the densities on the site. And I understand the concerns that have been raised, but I do think, as was said before, the densities are important to support the mix of uses and the retail on the site. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Michael Jaffe.
I was the former owner of the Arboretum Shopping Center and have numerous friends both in South Barrington, Hoffman Estates, and surrounding areas. I am an investor in the property with Anthony and others, including Michael. But I wanted to specifically speak to you as a shopping center developer, and like two or three of the other gentlemen that spoke tonight, give you a flavor of what retailers need and what your shopping centers and Hoffman Estates need to be continue to be successful. And that is more people. When we opened the Arboretum, which we looked at property both in Hoffman Estates and South Barrington, the plan then was to anticipate future growth and more people and densities nearby. As we all know, during the housing crush, that came to a complete stop. And I know that as I overheard some people's anxieties about growth and change, I understand them. I really do. I'm sympathetic to them. But I will say this, if growth does not continue out here, the ability for you all to have a healthy commercial base at that intersection, or for that matter in the surrounding area, but specifically at Route 59, or for that matter the project that I formerly owned, those are in question. The retailers want and need more people, more disposable income, and that's not something that's debatable. Those of us in the business, and I go back 33 years, hear it all the time. We tried so hard to get a grocery store out there year after year after year, and the only thing we heard over and over was, where are the rooftops, where are the people? Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you.
Hello, Melissa Buckley. I live at 90 Old Mill Court in Barrington. I've lived in the area for 30 plus years. I have a brother who lives in Hoffman Estates. A lot of my family lives in the area. And I've seen a lot of development in the Barrington area, including Hoffman Estates. And I think there's no doubt that this plot of land will be developed. And I would expect that it would be. My concern is that this particular proposal is so completely different from anything in the area, not just the Barrington area, but Hoffman Estates itself as well. And it just seems as if people have said before, it's so fast. And if you want to do something great, then take the time that that you need in order to do it and make sure that it's going to be successful and that the communities that it's going to impact are going to be successful as well. Because the last thing you want are families moving into this area with an expectation that maybe our school districts or your public service organizations can't support. So I would just encourage you all to take your time and not listen to and not react solely to the developers and the retail people who've just been speaking, because it's in their best interest to do this quickly, whereas we're all going to be here in the area for a lot longer than they will be. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor. Bob Palmer, Village Administrator in South Barrington, 30 South Barrington Road. Just one quick point. When we talk about density and we talk about development, we talk about rooftops. Just want to point out, the Arboretum has several new projects that are going to be forthcoming here. Seems to be doing very well with the density that we have in South Barrington. That's all I have.
Thank you.
Tom Coy, 27 Chaco Court, South Barrington. Thank you for giving us all the opportunity to tell you what we think of this proposal. First, the good news. We have no objection to the annexation. I don't personally have any objection to the annexation. Have no personal objection to the commercial on the corner of 72 and 59. Makes sense. What we're having difficulty with, myself and my neighbors, is putting 3,000 square foot lots, four or five story buildings across 59 from our 1 acre, half acre, quarter acre, single family residences. We think it's completely out of character with the path of development. And with all due respect to the gentleman who spoke about the Glenview project and the Libertyville project, both of those projects did not have the density that we're talking about in this development. The Libertyville project was about a block-long project in the middle of an existing downtown area. It's not on an empty farm in the far ring of the suburbs. The Glenview project was a rehabilitation of a naval air station with industrial properties on one side, a railroad and naval properties on the other. That's not what we have in South Barrington or in Hoffman Estates. So we really urge you to consider the density of this project as being completely out of keeping with the surrounding properties and the path of development. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mike Moreland, I'm the Building and Zoning Officer for the Village of South Barrington, 30 South Barrington Lane. Just real briefly, there's been a lot of conversation the last three meetings I've attended about density. I just want to set the record straight. People seem to be implying that the woods, the Clem Woods project is a higher density, especially the south end of it. I did some research going through the records today. That project in its entirety, from Higgins all the way up to beyond Penny Road, has a total of 392 housing units. That's it. Over 564 acres. That's 1.44 acres per unit. The so-called higher density portion, the south end, we call it the Regency, has 156 housing units on 97.4 acres. That's 5/8 of an acre per unit. We have a minimum lot width there of 70 feet. We have a minimum lot size of 9,300 square feet. Just setting the record straight on that. Thank you.
Thank you. If there's no one else who wants to come forward, Chair would accept a motion to adjourn the public hearing.
So moved.
I'll second.
Motion to second. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Motion carried. We are adjourned. Yeah, go ahead.
I'd like to call to order the General Administration and Personnel Committee on this April 17th, 2017. May we have a roll call, please? Present.
Vice Chairman Stanton.
Present.
Trustee Mills.
Present.
Trustee Newell.
Present.
Trustee Palafis.
Present.
Trustee Gata.
Present.
Mayor McLeod.
Present.
Thank you. We have a quorum. At this time, I'd like to suspend our meeting for the purpose of awarding two Great Citizens Award. So may I have a motion to suspend this meeting?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, please say
recess,
aye.
Recess.
Aye. I'm sorry. I meant recess. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We are recessed.
Okay. The purpose of this, we have a couple of awards to give. So we're going to go to the board meeting. We're going to do the called order and the roll call, the Pledge of Allegiance, do the two presentations to two citizens, then we'll go back to the General Administration and Personnel Committee. I'd like to call the Village Board meeting to order. Can you call the roll, Madam Clerk?
Trustee Palafis.
Present.
Trustee Stanton.
Present.
Trustee Gata.
Present.
Trustee Vandenberg.
Present.
Trustee Mills.
Present.
Trustee Newell.
Present.
Mayor McLeod.
Present. Can anybody please rise? Trustee Palafis, you want to lead us in the pledge?
Sure.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. And to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Chief, do you want to come on up?
Let me take those.
Why don't you read these?
Mike, would you like to come up first?
Good evening, Mayor and Board. I have a special presentation tonight, both on behalf of the Fire Department and the Village Board. Let me just read a little story here to you. On the night of January 8th, Mike Wiedelsbach, right?
Right.
Okay. Was traveling from his home in Crystal Lake to the Marriott Northwest to pick up the basketball team that played the Windy City Bulls the night before to transport them to the hospital. It was about 4:15 a.m., and he needed to be there by 5. So it was a frigid night. He was traveling south on Beverly Road off of Higgins Road. While driving on this road, he encountered two individuals, a man and a woman, walking in the middle of the road. The woman was limping and looked like she was hurt, and the man had his hands in his pockets and looked hurt as well. Neither of them had boots, gloves, or hats to protect them from the elements. When he came upon them, he stopped and asked them if they were okay and if they needed help. And they asked him to take them to the hospital. They reported they had been in a car accident and their cell phones had run out of power. And Mike gave them a ride. He drove them right up first thing to the Marriott Northwest. While in the car, he even noticed that the man was bleeding and the woman was definitely in pain. And Mike said to himself, what if these were my kids? Well, I would hope that someone would stop and help them. When he arrived at the Marriott Northwest, 911 was called. Our fire and EMS personnel arrived, and the man and woman were transported for treatment. A lot of people might have driven by or perhaps called 911 from a safe distance away and continued on. But Mike's unselfish nature triggered him to care and stop to see what he could do to help. And Mike, for your actions on that cold night and for the care you showed to these two individuals, I am recognizing you with the Hoffman Estates Fire Department Fire Chief's Letter of Appreciation. As well, the Village Board is awarding you with a Great Citizen Award, and I'd like you to read both of those for you. The Village of Hoffman Estates is proud to present the Great Citizen Award to Michael Wiedelsbach on Monday, April 17, 2017, in recognition of the kindness and compassion he displayed to individuals in need of help after an accident they had in their car on January 8, 2017. Mr. Wiedelsbach's concern for the well-being of the individuals, combined with his quick thinking, are the acts of service that ensure the village to continue growing in greatness. As well, my certificate reads the Fire Chief's Appreciation Award, presented the 17th day of April 2017 to Mike Wiedelsbach in recognition of your contribution to the Hoffman Estates Fire Department on January 8th, 2017 and for your willingness to go above and beyond in assisting occupants of a motor vehicle crash by bringing them in from the snowy and frigid temperatures and driving them to a nearby hotel to receive treatment for their injuries. So Michael, I just want to, on the behalf of the board and the mayor, thank you for all you do and for this kind gesture that you did and for the Hoffman Estates residents.
Thank you. Mike.
Go ahead and make your way through there. We're just going to hand you some hands with everybody up there.
Okay.
And then we'll take one more picture in front of the board, right up in front of the dais there. And we also have Mr. Brad Seymour from the Windy City Bulls in attendance here. He is working with him, with Mike, with the transport of the patients, or the teams and stuff.
Stay in the middle here and get a picture.
Okay.
Brad, come on up.
Ready?
Yeah.
1, 2, 3. One more. 1, 2, 3. Good?
Thank you.
Okay.
I have one more. On her way home from a friend's apartment on March 21st, along with her 8-year-old daughter, Melgarzada Rusteca spotted several bystanders looking at smoke coming from a building in her complex. When she realized that it was caused by a fire, she first asked if anyone had called 911. Because no one said they did, she told her daughter to go back to her friend's apartment to make the call. She then looked into the affected apartment and saw the fire. She asked if anyone knew if anyone was still inside, and they didn't know that either. She then went around to the north entrance of the building, went inside, and she saw the occupant of the fire unit in the hallway sliding down along the wall to a sitting position just outside of his unit. She noticed he had already sustained burn injuries, and she knew she had to get him out. She was able to see the fire starting to advance out of the doorway, and through persistence, convinced him to grab her shoulders to assist him up, and then she walked him outside to wait for the fire department to render aid. One other onlooker helped by placing a jacket over the patient's shoulders to keep him warm. She stayed with him until the EMS personnel were able to take over and get him the much-needed medical help. Without hesitation and concern for her own well-being, Malgarzada went right into the smoke-filled fire building looking to see what help she could be to anyone in the building. Upon seeing the patient, she knew she had to act fast in order to help him get out of the building. Once he was removed and our EMS personnel took over the care, he was transported to St. Alexis Medical Center and eventually airlifted to Loyola Hospital's burn unit for more specialized care. In addition to what she did that night, Malgarzada continued to reach out to the occupant, who we now know as Michael. She found out which hospital he was transported to and actually went to visit him. Since then, they have become close friends, and she has also met his family members. Michael is also here tonight, and I'm sure that if she had not done what she did that night, the outcome would have been much more serious. Malgarzada did something not every person would do. She put herself aside and tried to do something to help. In this case, it turned out to be something more special than she probably ever imagined. She helped save a life. So now, Malgarzada, I would like to present you with this Hoffman Estates Fire Department Citizen Life-Saving Award certificate. And that reads, presented the 17th day of April 2017 to Malgarzada Rusteca, in recognition of your participation in the assistance and removal of a victim from a fire in their apartment on March 21st, 2017, and for your willingness to go above and beyond in the selfless act of rendering emergency medical assistance to a fellow neighbor and assisting our personnel with patient care, resulting in a positive outcome of a life saved. As well, the board is also recognizing you with a Great Citizen Award. I'll read that. Malgarzada Rusteca, on Monday, April 17, 2017, in recognition of her extraordinary outpouring of compassion she displayed during a house fire that occurred in Hoffman Estates on Tuesday, March 21, 2017. Ms. Rusteca's quick thinking and desire to help a fellow resident is commendable and assures all of us that acts of human kindness propels the village to continue growing to greatness. And that's on behalf of the board, so thank you very much. Michael would like to speak briefly.
I feel great. My voice hasn't completely returned. We expect 100% recovery, however. And I just want to thank Maggie for her brave and selfless act, which I'm convinced saved my life. And I'm going to present you with this bouquet of flowers. And it represents every flower in the world. And every one of those flowers was to say, I thank you. It still wouldn't be enough to represent the gratitude I feel for you tonight for saving my life. Thank you so much.
If you would both, you can both walk through and
Shake hands there.
One more. One, two, three. There we go. Right. Thank you.
Very inspiring story. Thank you. This time, the chair would accept a motion to recess the board meeting and return to the General Administration and Personnel Committee, and we'll come back to the board meeting after the completion of the three committee meetings.
I'll make a motion to recess back to the committee meetings.
Second.
Motion is second. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have a motion carried. We are recessed.
Thank you. I would like to reconvene the General Administration and Personnel Committee meeting tonight. May we have a roll call, please, to establish quorum?
Chairman Vandenberg.
Present.
Vice Chairman Stanton.
Present.
Trustee Mills.
Present.
Trustee Newell.
Present.
Trustee Palafis.
Present.
Trustee Gata.
Present.
Mayor McLeod.
Present.
Thank you. We do have a quorum. I would like to entertain a motion for approval of the minutes from February 6, 2017, a special meeting.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. I would like to entertain a motion for approval of the minutes of March 20th, 2017.
So moved.
I'll second.
All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And I will abstain. Thank you. Under new business, we have four items. Item number one, discussion regarding legislative update.
So moved.
Just discussion.
Oh, discussion.
Mr. Norris, would you like to expound on anything?
In the interest of time, I would say that the state still hasn't done anything positive, and that about summarizes the legislative report.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Item number two, request acceptance of cable TV monthly report.
So moved.
A second.
Is there any discussion on this from the board? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Item number three, request acceptance of Human Resources Management Monthly Report.
So moved.
I'll second.
Is there any questions or discussion from the board? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. And finally, item number four, request acceptance of Legislative Operations and Outreach Monthly Report, March and April reports.
So moved.
I'll second.
Are there any questions to come from the board? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. President's report?
I'll wait till the board meeting.
Thank you. We do not have any other items in review, so I will look for a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
I'll second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And the ayes have it. We are adjourned.
I'd like to call to order the Transportation and Road Improvement Committee for the Village of Hoffman Estates on this April 17th, 2017. Roll call, please.
Chairman Stanton.
I'm present.
Vice Chairman Mills.
Present.
Trustee Vandenberg.
Present.
Trustee Newell.
Present.
Trustee Palafis.
Present.
Trustee Gata.
So moved.
Mayor McLeod.
Present. So accustomed to saying it. Right? Present.
I'm looking for approval of the minutes of March 20th, 2017.
So moved.
I'll second.
Anybody notice any corrections or deletions that need to be made? Hearing and seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Abstain.
Thank you. We have three items in new business. First is a request authorization to award a contract for the 2017 Street Revitalization Project to Arrow Road Construction of Mount Prospect, Illinois, which was the low bid, in the amount of $5,682,345.86.
So moved.
I'll second.
Mr. Anke, do you want to let us know what happened here?
Yes, just very briefly, there were five bids submitted this year for the annual street project. The low bid was submitted by Arrow Road Construction. They are qualified with the state of Illinois for this type of work. They have performed the annual street project on a couple occasions in the past and were also selected by IDOT last year for a federal STP project on Moon Lake Boulevard and Hillcrest Boulevard. The bid, the low bid amount was about $500,000 below what was budgeted. And it's great news, bid prices that we really haven't seen since about 2008. So the combination of the majority of the large ticket items were bid at a very low cost, resulted in a significant savings compared to what was anticipated to be budgeted for the project this year. As a result, we would recommend that Whispering Trails Court, which was not on the list when we did the budget last year, be added. It is included in the bid total, so if the board would like to do that, we would recommend that that street be reconstructed this year as well. This also leaves us with a positive balance going into next year. The scope also includes some other separately funded work, storm sewer, some public work, sanitary, and water main related work, which again can all be done under the budgeted amount.
Mike or Jim, do we need to add anything to this motion or request?
No, we're just very thrilled with the prices. Like Mike said, with petroleum prices being down, we'd expected this to happen over the last couple of years, and we didn't see it. And this year we saw, like Mike said, 2009 asphalt prices, which was wonderful.
Okay. Trustee Palafis, you had a question?
I was going to ask what you were going to ask, which was whether we need to amend the motion the second to include Whispering Trail.
Correct.
So you're saying we're good.
Mike, we need to add it in, or is that part of the recommended amount?
It's part of the recommended
amount.
That's
what I thought.
Okay.
Yeah, and I noticed, as did Trustee Mills, that it's already on the streets for reconstruction.
Yes.
So.
Yes.
Okay. All those in favor of the request, and the motion and the second, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? The ayes have it. Second, request authorization to award contract for materials testing for the 2017 Street Revitalization Project to Applied Geoscience Incorporated of Schaumburg, Illinois, which was the low proposal, in an amount not to exceed $125,000.
So moved.
Second. Second.
Thank you. Any discussion on this? All those in favor of the motion and second say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The ayes have it. Third, request acceptance of the Transportation Division monthly report.
So moved.
I'll second.
Any questions or concerns about that? Okay, hearing none, all those in favor of the motion and second say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The ayes have it. President's report.
I'll wait for the board meeting.
Thank you. We have nothing in other or items in review, so looking for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
I'll second.
All those in favor of the motion and the second say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? The ayes have it, and we are adjourned.
Before we start building, planning, and zoning, do we want to take a five?
That okay. Sounds good.
It is approximately 8:05 right now. We'll be back 8:15 at the very latest. Or okay.
Go ahead.
Look for. We'll take. Do I need to do a motion for that, or just? All right. We stand in recess for about 5 minutes.
Maybe 10.
Thank you.
Stevens.